The race starts from the San Francisco Bay, shrouded by the famous fogs which roll over the coastal hills like rivers of steam. The race crosses 2,200 miles of open ocean. The Pacific High controls the weather, which initially is often gray and windy, then becomes a classic northeast trade wind sleigh ride. Tracking the weather is crucial, looking for the tightest isobars and strongest winds. The finish is off the rugged north coast of the beautiful island of Kauai. Eighteen adventurers are entered. Favorite is Australian Ian Johnson, a professional sailor and co-owner with Kathy Hawkins of the Crowther 40-foot trimaran sponsored by Bullfrog Sunblock. Ian is one of the few sailors ever to have pitch-poled the same boat twice. Bullfrog is an immensely strong and safe boat, equipped with four autopilots, a drogue and parachute anchor. Jeff Hartz is a U.S. Coast Guard licensed professional skipper and is sailing the Marple's 44-foot tri-fat, the fastest American entry. Kiwi Peter Hogg won Lion Honors in the 1984 race in the Newark 40-foot catamaran Tainui. The boat has been modified following serious problems with the mast and coffin-like cabin. It is sponsored by Prime Computer and Construction Information Systems and is the state-of-the-art boat on the West Coast. In the monohulls, Dan Newland is favorite, sailing the Olsen 30 Francis Hu. Dan is another professional, having been a boat builder, rigger, and sailmaker, and won the 1982 race. Peter Clutterbuck is taking a sabbatical from the oil industry as a professional sailor. His boat Alliance is a CNC 38, normally raced by a crew of eight, and has been extensively modified to allow it to be single-handed. Alliance is the oldest and heaviest boat in the race, being five times the displacement of ultralight Francis Hu, and will need to be driven very hard to be competitive. She has three self-steering systems. Peter expects the boat to be a real handful in heavy air downwind and hopes that the high will go south, giving him a beat all the way. Hank Decker is partially sighted from glaucoma and is sailing the Laser 28 Out of Sight, equipped with braille charts and compass and talking navigation instruments. Hank was previously a professional racing car driver. Bud Fraze, previous winner of the 1985 Great Pacific Longitude Race, is sailing the Schumacher Capo 26 Unity. Mark Rudiger won the 1984 race on corrected time in his Carlson 29 Shadow Fox. Mark is a professional sailor and has crewed on four Transpacs. Jim Fair has been winning loads of single-handed and double-handed events on the West Coast and is sailing the Merrick 25 Chesapeake. He is taking four spinnaker poles and no chances. Linda Newland on the Hawk Farm 28 Predator is the only woman to have competed in the single-handed San Francisco to Japan race. Her goal is to beat husband Dan on corrected time. The race is won or lost long before the start line. Preparations are also crucial for safety, and all the skippers have been building experience for many years for the event. The single-handed Transpac has attracted people of a caliber unmatched in most of life's more ordinary circumstances. These sailors are self-reliant, individualistic, and knowledgeable. Even though dedicated to the goal of winning, they form a friendly, cohesive, and mutually supportive group, helping each other with preparations and getting together for discussions on strategy. The miles between San Francisco and Kauai have been, and will be again this year, the scene of both the best and worst that the ocean has to offer. Moments filled with pleasure and pain, joy and satisfaction when things are going right, anxiety and disappointment when expectations are not met. Of the 18 entrants, 11 are engineers, 7 are in the marine field, 2 have career military backgrounds. They are an intelligent and well-educated group. The vessels chosen by this year's competitors are as individual as their skippers. Built to withstand the rigors of the sea, they must also be durable and dependable craft. Here, Peter Clutterbuck is testing and commissioning a spinnaker snuffer system, which he has designed jointly with North Sails, to allow managing a sail which fully taxes a crew of 8 in a takedown. Weather research is fine-tuned as the start date approaches. The 40-foot Crowther Bullfrog Sunblock arrives from Australia. This boat is to revolutionize offshore trimaran design. Race director Frank Dinsmore is heading out to coordinate getting the mast lowered on board. Frank gets a nasty bang on the head as the mast is lowered. Watch out, Frank. Frank's in the worst possible place amongst spreaders, cross trees and rigging, and the anchor doesn't help. Peter Clutterbuck tows Bullfrog behind Alliance under sail. Navigate. Ian tests his grandfather's sextant.
And you can just read the thing.
Let's have a big smile, Ian.
Isn't that great?
What we're doing with that is because we've got a handheld VA.
The owner of Bullfrog, a waterproof sunblock for sailors and surfers, steps aboard.
So anyway, I think that more companies like myself could be interested through increasing the awareness of the great things these athletes go through.
On deck, and I looked up under the hatch, and there's kind
Dan,
of white.
Dan, at a safety seminar water, prior to the race, describes his previous experiences.
And I noticed after a little bit the sound hadn't abated. We've gone under for a little while now. I looked up and it was solid green over the forward hatch.
If any good, I'll have to take a gamble and take a northern course, which will be shorter than anybody else's, and just see how the weather is up. I think having the spinnaker up in a squall is what concerns me. It's a very big spinnaker, and if I'm asleep or if it's dark and something ugly comes up, I haven't really figured out what I'm going to do about it. So it may be a question of getting a knife out.
Hank Decker's vision is comparable to looking through a shower door, and he has to feel his way around the boat.
The thing I'm most concerned about is running it under spinnaker at night, or when I'm sleeping. You know, that's the only concern that it gets out of control then. But you're not really asleep, you're sensing the boat, and one has to react very quickly. The question is, can I react quick enough?
You had a problem with small boards on your previous module there. Can you describe what happened?
The problem on the 84 boat was that this cabin section was different, and it was rigidly attached to the crossbeams, and in heavy weather the boat racks a lot, and the racking loads were transferred to the cabin section, and it basically broke up by diagonal cracks underneath. It was also compounded by the fact that in a reaching sea the waves will break right onto the cabin, and it broke up and filled up with water, which was a little inconvenient. But this modified design was tested last year in the long pack race, and I don't have any problem with it.
You've got some problem with your mast as well.
Well, the problems with the mast, it's a Goujon wing section mast that rotates. It is mounted on a ball joint and stayed through a forestay and two running backstays. The problems I've had with it is this is the third mast I've had on it. The first one was a freestanding mast that broke. The second one was this mast on which I broke the top off it by sailing under spinnaker with a masthead spinnaker at high speed, and it took the top right off the mast. This particular mast I've had virtually no problems with.
At Transpac last time, that I definitely felt a presence, particularly at sundown when it started getting dark. There was a real ominous change in the personality and the moods of the ocean and you know, the weather, the clouds tend to seem to build up at night, and that's kind of when I felt defensive. Sunrise in the daytime, I felt pretty comfortable and at ease and more or less flowed with everything. And later, once you got into the night, it was okay too, but it was that initial darkening, and the wind seemed to always kind of pick up, and the clouds come up, and squalls and whatnot, so. That's where I feel the challenge. By the time I've got wind point and wind speed and a repeater all in line, which I found from the last Transpac on Lois, when you're tired at night and squalls, when you're dark, you're basically flying on instruments, so to speak. And without those instruments, it's just harder, particularly when you're tired. When you're single-handed, you're tired. When it's nighttime, you're almost always tired. So any kind of visual aids, I've got an off-course alarm now, which is a little more sensitive, and it also has the lights on it. And the Loran has an off-course alarm, and so things like that that, help me keep the boat sailing at its optimum all the time, even when you're about ready to pass out.
Press comment focuses on the rock stars. Mark Rudiger says the hardest part is the first few days. Here's Hank Decker and Peter Clutterbuck. This is Norton Smith, who has held the monohull record since 1977 at 13 days, 2 hours and 34 minutes. Dan and Linda will be celebrating their first wedding anniversary during the race. Linda is planning the single-handed BOC race after this. Dan and Linda will be racing neck and neck. And favorite Ian Johnson is treating it lightly. So the big day arrives, June 14th. It'll be 12 days for the fast boats and 20 for the slower ones.
Stay wide as we get up, I'll go in a little bit.
2 feet! Okay. 1 foot!
Michael, thanks for helping me, Michael. You got a great long time. Nothing else to do except go do it.
Go do it!
Alright. Bye. Good luck.
A cold front is approaching San Francisco, and the race will start with a beat. Competitors hoist their ensigns and their battle flags. 4 nationalities, many sponsors. Then they hoist their sails as the countdown approaches. Final weather reports come in over the VHF.
Time 1410, high 1022 millibar, 29 north 132 west, 1020 millibar isobar,
35
north 136 west.
This is Singlehanded race committing to the Singlehanded race boat, over. Stand Piper back. Stand Piper, which boat are you on?
The race has started, and Kiwi Peter Hogg in Tainui is hoping that his mast will stay up and allow him to beat Aussie rival Ian. But Jeff Hart sneaks up from behind on bat and takes his win. Both boats are aiming to be first to Hawaii, but both are to be dogged by failures. Peter with a mast-bearing failure, and Jeff with his best sail, an asymmetric spinnaker, destroyed after being run over by the big trimaran at high speed. Aussie Ian takes the lead as he beats out of the bay with battle flags flying on Bullfrog Sunblock. As the monohull start, Peter Rowe of Ocean Adventure takes over the commentary.
British engine Peter Clutterbuck, operating at CNC-38, was the leading monohull for several days until the race changed from a beat to a run and his big, strongly built boat lost its waterline advantage. In the blue boat, the 1984 winner, Mark Rudiger, duked it out with Jim Farr in number 45, Chesapeake, as if they were both match racing with a full crew. Farr, on a port tack, slides right in front of Rudiger. This is a 2,000-mile race, remember. Farr tacks again. 10 seconds
eight,
left.
9, 8, 7, 6.
Slides in
five,
front of Rudiger,
four,
then pulls
three,
his sails in.
2, 1.
The gun goes off. It's not over yet. Chesapeake tacks yet again, now heading straight for the committee boat.
Ian Johnson leads the fleet out the gate in a light sou'westerly. Kathy had really wanted to do this race, but hadn't got time to do the 500-mile qualifying solo passage, so Ian got to take the helm. Clutterbuck and Newland are neck and neck for the monohull lead. An alliance gradually overhauls Francis Hu, escorted by one of the press boats. These uphill conditions are ideal for alliance, but when the wind veers and freshens in the trades, the ultralight Francis Hu will take off. Alliance slides down the California coast with all systems operational, and Clutterbuck is thankful there are no more boat bills to pay for 2 weeks. Bullfrog sails too close to the rocks, and Clutterbuck takes the overall fleet lead. Shipping along the coast is a hazard for single-handers, most of whom carry radar detectors. This one is no problem, but it's a different matter at night or in thick fog.
The race has got off to a good start, with the wind out of the west, and a beat to Hawaii. I've stayed offshore and caught more wind, as I got into the lead, ahead of even the big multi-hulls. Alliance is the oldest and heaviest boat in the fleet, so the key will be to sail the shortest course and maintain speed with minimal breakages. The self-steering is working well. I have a wind vane for upwind work and an autopilot for light air and a homemade system of a tiller autopilot driving the vane, allowing a compass course control and very powerful response from the servo pendulum in the water. I've noticed that the wind vane unit was about to tear loose from the transom. It's coming off its mountings. I go over the stern to work on it as we reach along at 7 knots. Later on, a squall descended and the boat broached. I tried to clamber back aboard but lost my footing when a fitting sheared and I fell overboard. Fortunately, I had my life harness on and it saved my life.
I plot the weather information over the SSB radio. It looks like the high will split in two, forming a low trough. I take a big gamble and tack on to 230 degrees magnetic, taking a flyer to the north of the high as it spins off a lobe of the competition. I still have my transderm scopolamine anti-seasickness patches stuck behind my ear. Going on port tack is risky. The weather freshens and I'm opening up a lead. Alliance goes very well upwind and is easily managed with slab reefs and furling headsail. 3 days with virtually no sleep and I'm very fatigued. The first few days I wanted to talk to my support team, Bonnie and Jamie. A huge number of people had helped prepare the boat and I felt like an astronaut propelled out yonder by the team effort. The radio operator ashore thought I was a big ship, asking, "How many radio operators do you have aboard?" "One," I answered. "And is the call for the captain of the Alliance or one of the crew?" "The captain," I replied. The seas got rough as the wind freshened in the trough. Rain and wind built further. But the plan is working. We are leaving the rest of the monohulls behind. Then a line squall sweeps through with big, ugly black clouds, driving rain, cutting visibility to the yards. There it is, a mean old, black, ugly line squall. And the aftermath, some big seas breaking over the boat.
Described as hour upon hour of unrelenting boredom interspersed with moments of stark terror. About 11 o'clock, excuse me, 1100 hours, the wind seemed to pick up and very trade wind looking clouds appeared. I think this is probably the trade. However, the millibars were so high they're a little frightening. In fact, looked like we were higher in millibars than they predicted the high to be. That is to say that there shouldn't have been a high like that. But there's still wind, so that was the important thing, as long as the wind holds. Predictions for today say that the high was supposed to move right in on top of us, but so far it hasn't happened. With a little luck, maybe it could fall on my competitors further back. Not that I wish them any ill fortune, but I just want them to have a nice restful trip over. I also talked to Peter Clutterbuck on Alliance and saw some lights at 5 a.m. this morning. I thought they were a ship, tried to raise a ship and couldn't. and when I'm back down below, because I didn't see any running lights, so I figured it wasn't coming at me. As it turns out, it was Peter Clutterbuck, and he probably was all of a mile away, maybe even less, just right alongside of me. So it's very rare that you pass that close to anybody. Now, I owe him quite a bit of time by the time we get to the finish line. However, I think he made most of his time by going out early on and picked up a favorable wind shift. I think I'll be able to get him by the finish line, I hope. He tore a spinnaker, and I think he's a little worried about hoisting his other one. So he didn't have enough to really go and try and blow him apart. Of course, I don't either. And blown pretty good last night. It definitely felt like Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. Lots of rocking and rolling. And a boat frequently hitting 10s and 11 knots with an autopilot on rocking back and forth. It wasn't exactly a peaceful, calm night. Thank goodness I had my Teddy.
One thing last time I mentioned it, forget to mention it later, and that is how much I appreciated everyone showing up at the dock to see Lynn and I off. It really was, it's hard to explain. It's very, it's kind of emotional leaving a dock by yourself, because you know you're going to be out there all by your lonesome for a long time, and seeing everyone there wishing you off. It's just a real big morale booster. It meant a whole lot to me to see everyone there that cared, that here I was going off, I was going to be by myself, and yet everyone there was there behind me.
Also, tried all sorts of combinations, including spinnaker up, spinnaker down, reach her up, reach her down, spinnaker up again. Now I've now settled in with a lightweight number one, reaching, steering about 210, still trying to get a bit of south and things. The weather is west-northwest about 5 knots, and I'm hoping like hell that we don't get caught in the in that wind area. We'll just keep plunking like this for a few more hours and see what happens. Just been trying to get hold of the weather forecast on the WWV, and it's a great heap of shit. Don't understand any of it. The accents are so hard to interpret and everything's done so quickly. I've been trying to get it on the tape recorder and play it back, and it's too hard to discern. I hope later on when we get closer to Hawaii it'll be more easily understood. Tape just so that it's kept on record the shocking quality of the Transpac weather forecast. The guy who's doing that should be shot.
I have my largest chute, which has a pattern on it. Ounce and a half, bowl cut. I was in about 15 knots of wind, and I picked up RBF. And everything was peachy keen. I don't know, the autopilot couldn't deal with it at all, so I had to stand staring. When all of a sudden, the blue snapshot went up. Why, I have no idea. It must have got snagged on something and popped open. Anyways, things happened real quick after that. The bugger collapsed, wrapped up. Well, I fell off, unwrapped it and stuff, but in the process I was depending on the autopilot, he did downwind, it broached me. And in order to keep it from wrapping one more time, I had to drop it in front of the gap. So I dropped the halyard. Well, that works great on monohull, but it sure as hell didn't work too great on this. The sail came down all right and landed right in front of the boat. I proceeded to run over it at 10 knots. It was everything I could do to get to the halyard to cut them free. I didn't even have a chance to play with snap shackle back up behind. And so this beautiful $2,000 sail was being dragged underneath the boat. Well,
it's 12 noon out here. I just finished passing the halfway mark this morning. It's halfway mark, miles upon it. I'm more than halfway there. We're in the trade wind. Had these probably the last 2.5 days. These are beautiful. They're 15, 20 knots. Seas are 4 to 6 maybe. Or I should say swell. This is what Salem's all about right here. The sun's out, I got a t-shirt on, short. Hasn't always been like this, but it's like it now. Right now I'm wing and wing. If I had a spinnaker, I'd put it up, but I already lost that. Lost that on day 5. Decided I didn't want to stay on board. I'm just going with the working sails. I'm mounting between, 9 knots and 13 knots. It didn't too shabby, but this boat's capable of doing more under the right circumstances. And these aren't necessarily the right ones. My competition must be way ahead by now. He's probably... going to be in a good 2 days before I am. The race. As you can see, it takes a little bit of doing to keep the boat on track here. These swells kind of slap you around one way or the other. Plus, one time one arm is in the water, next time the other arm is in the water. So I'm doing this down the pace and end up all over the place.
Peter Hogg was to be plagued by mechanical problems. He had to stop Tainui dead in the water to work on the port quarter in sloppy seas. Not an easy job, but then Peter has thousands of miles solo on multi-hulls across oceans, so it's just like another day at work. Repairs complete. Tainui is off again on a fast broad reach with the knot meter back in the teens, hot on Ian Johnson's tail. This time the cabin hasn't yet been broken up by the seas, and Hogg doesn't have to worry about dropping through the floor into the sea below.
Hit the number of the truck that hit me. I feel like I've been really put through the ringer. Boy, I'm bruised and cut and torn and sore and stiff all over my body. All that climbing around, I'm sure didn't do much for my health. I was just checking yesterday, last night with the jib going out, I did 7.9 knot average. If I can keep that up, I don't know, maybe I can get a record, who knows? Another thing that really stiffened me up today was last night at about 1:30 in the morning. It was just getting too wild up there. The boat was having a real hard time steering, or the autopilot was having a real hard time steering with the amount of wind that I had, and the boat was just rocketing off the waves. I mean, we were doing 13 and a half knots on at least one wave, and I know there was others that were going at least as fast. And that's pretty scary when the thing's yawing back and forth. So I had to do a sail change, take some sail area down and put a smaller one up. Made it a lot more sane and it enabled me to get some sleep too, which I desperately needed. I finally did my first over on the side, get your butt knocked down, spreader in the water knockdown. In taking the spinnaker down, I got the thing on the autopilot, started grinding in the sheet and putting the pole forward, rounded up, the spinnaker filled, and over on our side we went. So I cast off the guy as quickly as I could, but not before the generator, which is down below at the time, had rolled from the floor to on top of the battery on the left-hand side, and everything else had gotten thrown everywhere else. My logbook and notes and everything got underwater because the cockpit got inundated.
The early part of the race was very tactical. The high is west and the wind arrows are black. The blue arrows show the fleet. On day number four, the high split in two, and several boats went between them, beating into a trough on port tack. The others got becalmed in the small high. As the high intensified, the trades filled in, and it became a classic sleigh ride, but the southern boats never caught up. The decision now for all the skippers was how close to cut the corner on the high, and how to optimize the hundreds of squalls racing down the trades.
We are now in the trades, but I am in despair. There is a bang and a tearing noise. The half-ounce chute has ripped beyond repair, from luff to luff. It is a huge rip, and an essential sail for the lighter conditions in the trades.
I launched the 3/4 ounce from the snuffer. The snuffer has been giving a lot of problems, jamming up 50% of the time, mainly because the rolling of the boat makes a cat's cradle out of all the halyards and rigging. The 3/4 ounce is my best spinnaker. And I must not lose it. It is a race to rush back to the cockpit and trim the sheet and guy before it wraps or rips. I've settled into a routine, sail changing, trimming, optimizing the self-steering, avoiding manual steering unless there's too much wind or too little wind for self-steering. At dawn on the 17th, I'm surprised to see a light on my port quarter, and then a sail. I'm even more surprised to raise Dan Newland on the VHF. He has to give me 11 hours at the finish line, and he really wants to get away from me. He asked me to pass a message to Linda on the SSB saying, "I love you, but you better not win," in reference to her vow to beat him on corrected time. Dan is busy getting his spinnaker up, trying to get away from me. His cooker is a burner in the cockpit, so he can cook while driving all day and most of the night. I've got my hard hat on to take the knocks off the spinnaker poles in the freshening conditions. Often I have two poles out for twin genoas when there's too much wind for the kites. Manhandling these poles is sometimes like tackling a rugby player. Albatrosses and porpoises are my companions. The porpoises are wonderful, always in a school, preferring to leap clear of the waves when going downhill, often jumping in unison in response to unheard signals between each other, repeating their acrobatics, time and time again, as if to impress each other and to entertain us solo sailors. Clipping on the lifeline is a good habit when going forward. Falling off is certain death, and for all of us is our biggest fear. The chance of survival is the same as falling off the Eiffel Tower without a parachute. Below the boom is a boom brake which controls jibes. The boom is another potentially lethal weapon. Knee pads for the foredeck work have also proved invaluable. We're now a third of the way into the race. We started off close hauled on starboard tack, then when the trough came through, tacked on to port. It has paid off, and Dan and I are ahead of the monohull fleet. The trades have freshened. I put up the big heavy-duty 1.5 ounce kite, which normally takes a full crew of 8 to handle. It's a risky business, as if a squall comes down, I may not be able to get it off. In heavy conditions, twin genoas are easier to handle and just as fast. The big seas get my 9-ton boat, the heaviest and oldest in the fleet, surfing almost out of control. And the self-steering is stretched to the limit, trying to avoid a broach or a wild jibe which could bring the mast down. I'm always on the lookout for squalls to get the kite off before they hit. At night, they come without warning, the only sign being the stars going out and a pitch black descending as the wind and rain come down. At dawn, it's time to pile on the canvas again. At night, the flying fish hit the boat, the sails, and sometimes me. At dawn, it's time to collect them and fry them for a nice breakfast. We are now in mid-Pacific, and the sailing is fantastic. Big seas as the wind builds to force 6 or 25 knots. Each one picks us up, and we surf 9, 10, 11 knots, day and night. The main has been dropped and lashed to the boom. We've blown a hole in the blooper and the drifter, which I ran over after a heavy air drop, tangling around the wind vane steering oar. It's now turning into a race to get there before everything wears out. The rudder has been creaking ominously, and now the whole cockpit is coming loose from the hull, making loud cracking noises every time it moves, preventing me getting any sleep in the quarter berth. I bolt it all up with teak and epoxy. The spinnaker halyards are fraying badly. My main sheet traveller has sheared in a squall, requiring cannibalizing the baby stay for parts. The weather has become unpleasant as we approach Hawaii. Big squalls hit at night, descending pitch black. In the day, the sun rises to 89 degrees, almost vertical. The heat's intense. I try to avoid sail changing in the heat of the day, and I find that even in good conditions, I need to drink a gallon of water to set and douse the spinnaker, along with several salt pills. I realize I can only do it a limited number of times before I drink all my water supplies. Loran out here is unreliable, so I'm using the sextant to check my sat-nav positions. Everything seems to tie up pretty good. The solar panel here is working terrifically, keeping the batteries fully charged and able to keep up with all the electronic demands. Knee pads on and hard hat on again for some more foredeck work. Dropping the spinnaker pole, here in relatively good conditions. In rough weather, I quite often have to manhandle it down using my head as a third arm.
What you're looking at is one mast without lowers. I ended up losing a lower shroud about half an hour ago.
Well, the time is about 1900, and I just got through patching the shrouds. That might be a real problem on finishing the race. I think I got enough wire on it, but I don't know. It's halyard wire. 7x19 is just not the same as 1x19, and those two halyards and the baby stay seem to have the mast and column. I've lost a little time, but not too much to where I can't make it up, but I don't know if I can push the boat as hard as I did before. It's going to be a little tough. This Kevlar spinnaker does not take any shock. It just gives very big loading on the rig. And if I can't push the boat, I might be in serious trouble on the standings. Just won't know. I'll only be able to tell when I get into the finish, I guess. But we'll see. It seems to be a reasonably good patch, but patching isn't necessarily the same as having your rig completely whole. I don't know, but I guess I'll go see.
Well, I gotta go ahead and put on a little bit of the good stuff here. Probably the sponsors would like this. We may get a little bit of film action on that. I just had a pretty good little puff. We'll see what happens.
Glad
last night was certainly a good night. I only had about 3 accidental jibes, and 1 jibe this morning while I was having breakfast, where I did a 360 degree turn.
It is after I jibed and I reset the spinnaker, I took a pretty horrendous knockdown in the hoist, and many of the contents of the cockpit spilled into the drink. Among them was my logbook. Boy, I'm sure looking forward to spending a little time with Linda and getting a little R&R. This 30 feet is becoming a lot like a 30 foot long and a 9.5 foot wide prison.
Well, that's a weather forecast. They're forecasting 15 knots the other side of what we got. Yep, plenty today. Got a reef in Maine. Tiding along at 7 to 8 knots. First to 9, 10, 11 knots when we're surfing. And we got a couple of days to go to get to Hawaii now. Playing out our position, everything is telling up pretty good. I picked up a radio station today from Maui, and that confirmed the satellite pictures that I am and the flights we started doing. And in comparing opposition with the other competitors, two big Pacific Trial and Shadow Fox, who are all my main rivals for the Georgia Prime first place. And it looks like I'm headed to the very boring accident if I just get that. I get in ahead of them. I don't know where Neil is. He's the mystery man. He doesn't know a single time, man, so nobody knows where he is. If he gets in first, he'll be first to finish the model. He may also get the alarm time trophy as well. If he does, congratulations to him on the achievement. So far, got in, broke the record, well done again. I bet you're having a cold beer and a hot bar, which I'm planning on in a couple of days. So, anyway, this is the nerve center of Alliance here, and we're all paperwork done. Going to modern version racing electronics here. And kind of interesting when I'm asleep and the alarm goes off, that's what it is, so many of them. Should be my alarm clock, or my egg time, which is a 50 minute time down, things like weather forecast. Should be the satellite, throwing their satellite just about to get over. Should be the alarm clock, and it's going to be a problem with single charge or dial skipping. It should be my low battery alarm. And it could be my radar check, which actually just went off about an hour ago, first time in a couple of weeks. It's not a big battleship, we know it's a big wave. Big battleship all down over the horizon. Well, everything's going really well. We've got a couple of days of light air, and now we're back into heavy stuff in a landslide. Hard work living in these conditions down here. So we've got a reason to man going like smoke, and Alliance loves it. She's very competitive in the air.
Here's my blooper, fixed up and pulled out. I've been racing against an Aussie, a Kiwi, and 15 Americans. The wind is light now, and I'm getting through a collection of 15 presents from Bonnie, one a day. One was a single-handed table tennis game. The best was a mouth organ and a book called Learning the Harmonica for the Musically Hopeless. As I was over 200 miles from the nearest competitor and didn't see a ship or plane for 2 weeks, I knew I wouldn't upset anyone, as I am indeed musically hopeless. Sunrise was always a relief after long sleepless nights. Pajamas were great for keeping the midday sun off. Below was always a mass of spinnakers, all needing repacking and banding, then stowing inside the squeezer. The beautiful 3/4 ounce kite has been a great workhorse, but I've had some hairy times getting it off in the squalls, needing all my strength and a few prayers.
I just got down and taking the big 3/4 ounce off in 25 knots of wind. I'm going to go around here and turn it off. I'm going to do it to the story. The tree is breaking out into that technological step into that two steps of the time.
We had a rough day yesterday. I don't know if you heard or not, but I lost the port halyard and I decided to go get it, and I did. I was mighty tired and bruised afterwards, but I got it down, and then I hooked it up again to the chute. I hoisted the chute instead of hit the top, and the darn thing released again. So then I had to drag in this sopping wet ounce and a half, which was kind of like battling a waterbed heat.
And then finally I got the darn,
she decided to do a broach and she did it, but he didn't split, put the pole in the water and flooded the, water inside and down inside the boat itself. And I called Linda up, I was so shook, I got on the VHF and I said, you know, if anybody out there, I knew where it was pretty good by accident. I just had my first broach in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, over.
Yeah, roger that. I've been doing, like I said the other day, I've been kind of on a rule of thumb here. When I can't count the broaches on my fingers anymore, I get to my thumbs and I start thinking about taking the thing down. I had an ollie around down yesterday, and all my charts and notes and everything all got wet. I don't know if you heard about my going up the mast, but the first time I got a third, I got two-thirds of the way up, and I'm trying to keep the boat moving, help stabilize it. And the thing started to roll away, and I went, oh shit. And sure as hell, it kept going and died. The main slammed over and hit the runner, and the boat was just pinned down sideways in the water, and a third of the way underwater. I'll tell you, that's an eerie feeling. Sitting up the top of your mast, looking down at your boat half underwater. It's gonna stay there until you get down and release that runner. So I just kinda slid down the main and ran back there and blew it off, and boy, that was quite a scene there.
By mid-race, the high was big and powerful, squeezing the trades into fresh northeasterly force 5 to 6, 25 knots, great surfing conditions. By day 11, it had weakened below 10-20 millibars and drifted southeast over the top of the back end of the fleet, who were becalmed. The front runners escaped, but the wind lightened up for them also.
I think motivation has a lot to do with it. People who are comfortable with themselves and have, an easygoing personality, I think have an easier time adjusting to being alone for long stretches of time and being in a confined space. People that tend to be higher strung and have, anxieties have a much more difficult time dealing with it.
Today is Thursday, 8:48, time. If you want to know what hell is, this is hell. I can't believe it. I am less than 150 miles from my last home. And here I am doing 2 to 3 knots in rain. I'm getting rained on every 15 minutes. And
thank you.
I've had it. I don't want this anymore. This is the pit, not what I call fun. This has got to be, if there is a hell and I ever go there, this will be it. They will just leave me in this frickin' mess for eternity. People always want to know what strange squalls are like. One minute you got wind, the next minute you got this. You know, you either got too much wind or not enough. The wind's been going around the clock. One minute it's on my nose, and it's on my beam, and I've just been going around and around and around. This is getting quite old. Now, my landfall, if it was 2,000 miles away, I could really give a shit. But it's just over the hill. This frustrating. I mean, I can almost reach that pina colada.
The ball joint on the base of Tainui's mast shears off, and Hogg has to jury-rig it.
Yeah, okay. I'm 15:30 on the 24th, and right up ahead, right on the button, exactly where it was supposed to turn up, is the island of Kauai. A bit of damage.
Ian Johnson smashed the record by 9 hours, with a time of 10 days, 10 hours, and 3 minutes. Johnson had got stuck in a trough between two hills, then headed north to catch the stronger winds, and put in a best day's 24-hour run of 350 miles, a 15-knot average speed. Towards the end of the race, the battens started failing in the main, and he did much of the remainder of the race under spinnaker with no main. The last 2 days he hand-steered, taking only half-hour catnaps, crossing the finish line at 16 knots, a fantastic achievement. Peter Hogg's broken mast rotation ball put him into third place with a time of 14 days, 7 hours and 3 minutes, 34 hours behind Fat. Peter was, however, to get some ideas from Bullfrog, and he was to dominate the race in later years. Francis Hu was the first monohull, but the broken lower shroud cost Dan Newland the record by 4 hours. His time was 13 days, 6 hours and 42 minutes.
I'm looking for Kauai, as I only have a few miles left. Sure enough, there's a grey shape behind the squall clouds on my port bow. I check the bearing with the hand-bearing compass. Soon the weather clears to reveal the most beautiful landfall imaginable. Rugged, jungly pinnacles, cane fields, and the sheer 3,000-foot drop of the Nepali coast. I drop the kite to make the boat more manageable and pull out my Genoa on the pole. I feel in better shape than ever before, well exercised, physically and mentally. The horn blows. The race is over. Officers escort me to my anchorage. I have placed second in the monohulls behind Dan Newland, and was second in class. Bonnie steps aboard with a lay, cold wine coolers and champagne.
Got to commit to the race at least 6 months in advance. And you'd find normally that if you're starting out with a new boat, you need a year. You need to be able to shake the boat down, tune it up, take it out in heavy weather. There's a 400-mile single-handed nonstop qualifier for this race in which you get a chance to shake things down. There's just constant tuning and trimming and practice that you have to do. That commitment really then leads to the second thing on my list, which would be motivation. You've got to commit to win, and from that comes the motivation to be out there trimming and driving and doing sail changes. And it's a lot of times it's fun, but a lot of times it's work, and you can't be afraid to work for your victory. And then I'd say the next most important thing really is going the right way. And then probably right up in that same category of importance is you've got to make it. Obviously, if you don't finish the race, you can't win. So.
Bullfrog had got in 29 hours ahead of Fat, which in turn was 34 hours ahead of Tainui. Francis Hu placed 1 and Alliance 2 in the monohull fleet, benefiting from the stronger winds in the north, while the rest of the fleet lost out by heading south. Hank Decker arrived on a pitch-black night and was guided in by the shore crew.
And he thinks it would be better if we just looked through your masthead light. Over.
I don't have any vision, remember? Over.
Yeah, well, if you can see Kilauea Lighthouse, you have some, so whatever you've got will be helpful to you. Over. Go ahead, change course, and let us know what course you're taking, okay?
Roger. Right now, I'm at 159 degrees, 31 and 2/10 minutes. And I'm going to make my turn now, and I'll advise you what course I'm headed. There's a spin to mine. I had a bad spinnaker wrap, but then I had a spinnaker around the top of the mast. And after I got it down, I wonder if that might not have taken off my spinnaker, which is mounted up mast. At the
masthead,
over.
We think that you may have actually passed the bay.
Hank was tracked down and guided in. Linda Newland corrected out 4 days behind husband Dan. And hats off again to Ian for setting new standards in offshore transocean solo sailing. Ian and Kathy raced Bullfrog in the Hawaiian Islands. Ian fell and broke the safety net going overboard. He was lucky it didn't happen on the solo race, which would have been certain death. Ian and Kathy sailed through the South Pacific Islands to Tasmania. They went on to campaign Bullfrog, breaking more records and winning almost everything. They placed second behind Peter Blake's 60-foot Tri-Steinlager in the Stormy Round Australia race. Kathy soloed Bullfrog across the Tasman Sea and survived being hit by lightning. Then they sold the boat and raised a family. Mark Rudiger went on to be the navigator on the winning Whitbread 60 EF Language in the 1997-98 Round the World race. Dan Newland built a custom boat, a Newland 368, and won the 92 single-handed Transpacific race. Peter Hogg was first to finish in the 88 race, then Tainui was destroyed by whales. Peter built an Antrim 40 trimaran, Aotea, which was first to finish in the 90 race, then broke the record in the 92 race. Peter then broke the single-handed record from the USA to Japan. Aotea was later pitch-bowled and lost, eventually washed up the other side of the Pacific a year later. As more finishers rolled in, there were some good sea stories. Delois Alcorn had taken sticks of dynamite with 4-second fuses to launch from a catapult at ships on a collision course. We all played chicken on the beach, counting the 3.5 before letting go. Peter Cameron arrived under damage control on a pitch-black night, saying, "There is something very large out here, breathing very deeply. Its tail is on my starboard side and its head is on my port." Peter Clutterbuck sailed back with Bonnie Rollison, 2,000 miles of which was in heavy seas under jury rig, in winds to 65 knots. They then sailed on to England, got married and raised a family. Peter campaigned the 40-foot try as Spirit of England in Europe and the Atlantic, winning 12 events and breaking 2 records. Frank Dinsmore has some final words.
And I tell you, the guy sailed a terrific race. I would just horrendously impressed. Peter Clutterbuck in Alliance. Yeah.